to meet you, Matt Ferrara.
I am so glad that you were able to join us.
Oh, thank you very much. Thanks for the invitation.
This should be an interesting exchange.
Okay. It should be.
You do certainly have your part.
Good morning, Mary Sue. We have your space reserved for you next to Dr. Ferrara.
How are you doing?
Good, good.
Long time no see.
I know.
I try to.
My wife makes me clean up before I get out.
Good on her part.
Exactly.
Hello.
Hi. I know, we talked about them. Because it's not consistent with what they're trying to do. They're trying to get reelected.
Okay.
Yes, very well. We'll start in just a minute.
Oh, no problem. And I may at some point just put this on my head. Once everyone has established I have hair.
Okay, good morning and welcome. It may look like the audience is rather small, but remember, this is being broadcast on the World Wide Web, and I think on a cold morning like this, a lot of people prefer to watch from their bed. So, without further ado, let's give our speakers their say. Yasmin Nair, we've of course heard from once already, and here she is again this morning. As you remember, Yasmin is a blogger, activist, a co-founder of the Organization Against Equality, a queer critic of the mainstream gay rights movement. The reason she's coming to us via Skype is that she is in Chicago and for various reasons is unable to travel. But we had a good experience listening to her on Friday, and we look forward to hearing what she has to say about the consequences of American sex offender policy. Yasmin.
Thank you. And once again, my thanks to Tom Hubbard, and also I just wanted to also express my gratitude and also just acknowledge how difficult it can be to have panels like this, given the culture and climate that we live in. We live in very dark times as far as sex offender registries are concerned, and as far really as the prison industrial complex and the carceral state are concerned. And sex offender registries in particular have widened and deepened in depth and complexity, ensnaring almost everyone we can think of in terms of status and so on. And the backlash against anyone who protests those laws can sometimes be very strong. So I really do appreciate this panel. But I also appreciate very much being allowed to be on the same panel as Bill Andriette. He's an old friend and comrade of mine, but he's also, more importantly, the person in some ways, I'm such an acolyte of Bill. If you haven't followed, if those of you in the audience and watching this haven't followed Bill Andriette's work, you really should. But Bill's work has been prescient in terms of determining exactly where, what kinds of horrible consequences sex offender registries could lead to. And he's been extraordinarily brave about all of this work for a very, very, very long time. And, you know, Bill, I love you and I salute you. And I'm so proud to be on this conference panel with you. Thank you so much. And without further ado, what I'm going to do today is give really, just to sort of set up this panel, is to give a broad history of sex offender registries in the United States. And then to look at a very particular case in recent cultural memory and history, case of Caitlin Hunt, a teenager, a Florida female teenager who was charged with as a sex offender. Just to give quickly a brief history of sex offender registries, in the wake of gay marriage, which we discussed before, and a larger gay rights agenda consisting of hate crimes legislation and, of course, the end of DADT and so on, and all the celebration around what many of us queer radicals would refer to as a mainstream gay agenda, the questions and concerns surrounding sex offender registries have been mostly ignored. You might wonder, what does it have to do with LGBTQ people? Historically, in fact, this is what my paper will rely upon, is the fact that historically it's the figure of the gay man in particular as a sexual predator which still haunts culture, continues to reemerge, and which in fact actually overdetermines exactly how sex offender registries are constructed and also what kinds of punishments and so on are meted out to people. And we've had many famous, or rather infamous, sex scandals over the decades. In 1955, in Boise, Idaho, the very famous case, which has also been discussed in a documentary, of a sex scandal involving almost 1,500, that's 1500 men, who were questioned about allegedly having co-operated young men into sexual acts. There was, of course, as it turned out, there was no such sex ring, but as it's been was made clear, countless lives were scarred forever. And since the 1950s, actually, as far back as that, sex offender registries have been instituted in every US state. Ostensibly, the idea of sex offender registries is to prevent sexual abuse of minors and others by tracking everyone convicted of sexual abuse. Now, in the LGBTQ community, particularly, of course, as we know, the gay community, the question around intergenerational sex has been one that has come up over and over again until recently, where it has pretty much been squelched out of existence. But as we all know, within the queer community, intergenerational sex and the issue of consent and the issue of sexual relations between people of different generations has always been one that has preoccupied our attention for various reasons. One of which, of course, is that there are all kinds of reasons historically in terms of the discussion of homosexuality, what we call pederasty and so on, but also that particularly, even now, for instance, when young teens run away, historically, they have been able to find older, often gay male adults to take them in. And there have been interesting relationships that were not necessarily around sexual coercion, right? May have involved sex, but were not about sexual coercion, and were actually about one person getting comfort and support from another who might have been older. So there are these very complicated ways in which intergenerational relationships, sexual or not, have been configured within our community. And that has increasingly over the years become simply marked as pederasty, sodomy, exploitation of minors, and so on and so forth. Now all of this, of course, I want to be clear, is not to say that this does not happen, that there is not sexual exploitation. But again, the point here being that those complications have been erased, and that, I think, is what this conference is going to do, is to trace out those more complicated nuances. Now, in terms of sex offender registries and their history, there have been various pieces of legislation that have ratified, solidified who gets to be defined as a sex offender. Also, the important thing, of course, is the establishment over the years of various pieces of legislation that have in turn established verifiable databases of sex offenders. What this means for us is that you can, for instance, in any state, type in, there is no such thing as privacy, which is very different from the United Kingdom, for instance, but in the US, there's no such thing as privacy if you've been defined as a sex offender. You simply go online and find anyone in your neighborhood. There are ways to figure out whether someone in your neighborhood or whether in your state or on the street, right next, a few blocks over, might be a sex offender. And that has, of course, led to, as Bill will explain really well, I think, has led to some really particularly heinous instances of people being tracked down and murdered, for instance, and killed as sex offenders by vigilantes, basically. But a quick run through of some of the essential pieces of legislation. The Jacob Wetterling Act of 1994 created the registry that would enable easier tracking of sex offenders. Megan's Law, with an amendment to that, named for Megan Kanka, raped and murdered by a neighbor and convicted pedophile in 1994. And it's Megan's Law which created the communication notification system, which requires all convicted sex offenders to register whenever they move and on a periodic basis. And if you talk of sex offenders on sex offender registries, essentially once you are on the registry, your life is over. There is no other way to put it. Life is essentially over. You have to report constantly, but not only that, your attempts to gain meaningful employment, your attempts to go to school, your attempts to have leisure time, everything is reduced drastically. You're not allowed to go near parks, for instance. You're not allowed to go. You cannot even enroll in a school if there's a possibility of underage minors. It is utterly horrendous. Essentially, if you are today in the US registered as a sex offender, your life is over, you might as well just live in a cold, dark box. There is no other way really to put this. Over the years, sex offenders have not just tightened in terms of their regulations, but they have actually broadened in scope to include a myriad of refer to those as SORs. She has said, we need to keep side of the girl, no more victims. We need to be realistic, not all sex offenders are the same. We need to ask tougher questions. What can we do to help those who offended, who have offended, so that they will not do it again? What are the social factors contributing to sexual violence, and how can we turn things around? And this is actually a remarkable, almost transformative justice statement coming from a woman whose child was, in fact, killed, who has been directly affected by SORs, and it speaks to the kind of backlash that we are slowly but surely seeing. The Federal Abortion Act, or AWA, was passed in 2006, named for, again, very famous case, a six-year-old abducted from a Florida mall, who was later found decapitated. States have to comply fully with the AWA or incur penalties for non-compliance. Well, that's also very interesting. The various states like California have actually gone ahead and just incurred the penalties for non-compliance because the compliance is so complicated and so onerous sometimes. So that's another complication out there. And as I said, sex offender registries have increased so much in scope. I'm sure those who are coming to this panel are probably aware of that. But just to, so that we're all on the same page, they've increased so much in scope that even acts like public urination can fit the category of sex crime. In as you know, they've become virtually meaningless. They place so many residential and vocational restrictions on offenders that larger numbers are unable to return to society with places to live and stable systems of support. It's very important to remember that there are actually in many cities and towns populations of people, mostly men, not all, mostly men, who literally have to wander from bridge to bridge or from motel to hotel to city hotel, because it is so difficult to determine where one can actually live as a sex offender because of the onerous restrictions upon their mobility, upon everything really, frankly, as you know, terrible to breathe in our society. Now, the term sex offender, or pederast, or sodomite, however, but really, sex offender, is rarely uttered at gay and lesbian events, raising as it does an old and time-worn stereotype that still causes fear, particularly among gay men, because of its automatic association with terms such as pedophile and sodomite. Now, to date, none of the major gay and lesbian organizations, which have enormous amounts of money, as I explained the other day, has explicitly taken, or even actually implicitly, has simply not taken any kind of position on issues concerning sex offender registries. Even though there is mounting evidence of LGBTQ people in particular being specifically targeted, and again, for that I would refer you for more details on how LGBTQ people are specifically targeted as sex offenders, I would refer you to my piece on sex offender registries, which I did for the Windy Times. I can have that put up somewhere. It's on my website. But there's a long history of how they're actually specifically targeted. So despite that, HRC and GLPF, Lambda Legal, none of these will actually take explicit positions against sex offender registries. But there are, in fact, gay sex offender offenders on the registry. And there have always been widely sensationalized cases of alleged embryonic sexual abuse of children by men who also identify as gay. And again, if you get the opportunity, if I could just take a minute again to say this, if you get the opportunity, please do check out not only Bill's wonderful work in The Guide, which was a left magazine cleverly disguised as a gay travel magazine until it went out of print circulation. It was one of the only places where there was any kind of vigorous questioning of sex offender registries. Also, of course, there was infamous cases like that of Shanley. Some of the work is still archived, and you really should look that up. And now, tracing the effects of sex offender registries on LGBTQ people reveals that both terms, LGBTQ or gay and lesbian, and sex offender are fraught with multiple tensions and definitions. For instance, not all people convicted of sex offenses are, of course, LGBTQ. But the sexual acts, such as oral and anal sex, which place them on the registries are defined as quote-unquote crimes against non-heterosexual that places LGBTQ people in particular danger. And again, I do want to emphasize that across the range, and I want to emphasize how complicated the legal aspect of all of this is, because across the range of these laws, there are just so many complexities that even parole officers don't know what to do. It's very difficult to track of the constant changes. That's the other problem for a lot of people on sex offender registries, is that the laws change so much that they live in constant fear of violating laws that are changing without their knowledge. And that is just, it's beyond Kafkaesque. It's just a horrendous, horrendous situation for most people. The fact that sex offenders, now, because sex offenses and sex offenders fall into such diverse and disparate categories, and so you have a range of acts, you have a range of people, so it's across, not so much really across class, but for the most part, it cuts across many different demographics, rural populations, urban populations, women, men, because it is such a diverse population, it has been very hard to mobilize a concerted political movement against the prevalence of SORs, because it's very difficult for people to actually feel and feel that they're part of a larger community. One thing, they're very isolated, and then for another, they all come from such very different backgrounds. Mobilizing a movement can be very difficult. There are, of course, organizations like ARSOL, which Tom and others will talk about. There have been systematic critiques, such as the Human Rights Watch in 2007 issued 146-page critical people with no easy answers. And as I said, there have been scholars like Corey Rippin Young have studied sex offender registries and pointed out that they are very much linked to the war on sex offender, the war on drugs. And there's a very interesting political and cultural analysis to be done in terms of how the war on drugs is replicated in the war on sex offenders and its enormous range and whom it affects and so on. So all of that, I think, is also interesting to talk about as we move forward. But for today, what I want to do is end on, in the last few 7-odd minutes that I have, is talk about Caitlin Hunt. Now, earlier this year, she was charged with this lewd and lascivious. Caitlin Hunt was a Florida teenager. It's very important to remember that she was a beautiful white teenager. A friend of mine, again, you can find photos of her online. A friend of mine looked at her and described her as someone that looked like she belonged in Lord of the Rings, elvish. A very beautiful, blonde, young, beautiful big green eyes, blonde hair. She was charged, to much of the astonishment of many people, with lewd and lascivious battery on a child 12 to 16 years of age. That's the legal definition. The child in particular, in this case, was 14. She was in a relationship with a younger woman. The relationship had begun in 2012, in May of this year. The lawyers, she was charged, she turned 18. What is interesting about this particular case is the amount of attention it invoked in the public and in mainstream publications like the New York Times and BuzzFeed, name it, across the board, the media took up this case in great outrage. Caitlin Hunt's parents, again, if you look at the details of the case, if you look at my particular investigation of the case, Windy City Times, what you discover is that Caitlin Hunt's parents actually distorted the facts of the case. They tried to change the age at which she had been arrested. They kept claiming that the other child's parents were actually being homophobic. There's actually no real evidence of that. But the larger point here is that the case was drummed up as a case of homophobia against a young woman who's just in love. The other complication that no one has really discussed is that the younger woman is biracial. Her parents, her mother is African American, her father is white. So there was also this nasty little undercurrent of homophobic black people. There were all these very complicated narratives wound into this case, but essentially, the entire case became projected as a Juliet and Juliet scenario. And there was on her behalf, collected many, many signatures worldwide. There was much outrage that this beautiful young woman had been prosecuted so unfairly. And then, you know, there's actually a Facebook page called Kate. It collected over 200,000 signatures. And there was a viral campaign. The author Anne Rice, no less, pitched in with her support. The group Anonymous at one point decided it was going to take down Irula's staff, all those who needed to be held accountable. I have no idea why Anonymous would have gotten into this, but it did. So there was, it was really frenetic. And there was a backlash against the state of the police office and so on. The ACLU, about which I will refrain from commenting because I have so many issues with how the ACLU is conducting itself these days, but the ACLU even posted a statement in support of Caitlin Hunt. It did not actually start, it did not take a case on her behalf, but it pitched in support. So all of this went on. It's mass hysteria around how, the point was to keep her out of jail. If jailed on the charges, she would be facing many years down the line in prison and, of course, possibly be marked as a sex offender for life and so on and so forth. So the point, of course, was to keep her out of prison. All of this was going along until very recently, in August, September, when it was discovered that she had actually violated all the conditions of her parole, which included not being in contact with the younger woman. So, and she had actually sent, they had exchanged approximately 100,000 texts minor interactions. And she writes that that experiment has happened with such little critical interrogation from the general public and from all square as we march towards assimilation. Now is a politically important moment for LGBTQ people to interrogate these claims of protection being made. Who benefits from them? Who doesn't? Because decades ago, those claims were also being leveled against us. And I'll end with that. Thank you so much.
Okay, Yasmin, we're going to shut off our Skype connection with you now, but we will call you back when we get to the question period.
Absolutely. Thank you. I'll be watching. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Mary Sue Molnar, who is a local Texas activist. And again, one of my goals in this conference has been very much to get people familiar with the local scene here, to speak to our international guests and our guests coming from all over the country about what's going on here in Texas, which is, of course, a state that is known for particularly severe enforcement of, well, virtually all realms of criminal law, but particularly this one. Mary Sue is really a vigorous presence on this question. She's the executive director of Texas Voices for Reason and Justice, which is an organization that lobbies for criminal justice reform in the area of sex offender laws. And today she's going to talk to us specifically about the residency restrictions and child safe zones around the schools and their lack of effectiveness. So Mary Sue, please speak to us and enlighten us.
Good morning. Is it on? Can you guys hear? Thank you, Dr. Hubbard, for the invitation to speak. And I feel almost inadequate listening to the educated speakers from yesterday. So I will tell you that I don't have a degree, and I don't have letters behind my name, and I've gained my education from the School of Hard Knocks. So I speak a little more from the heart than from a scholarly perspective. But Texas Voices is a nonprofit organization working specifically in Texas. We are dedicated to promoting a more common sense, rational, effective criminal justice system as related to people who are required to register. We do that through education, educating the public, which is not an easy task unless someone's family member or themselves have been affected by sex offender laws. Typically, the public believes that everyone on the registry is a monster. Education is big for us. We try and encourage our members to speak to their family, their coworkers, neighbors. Legislation, we work a lot at the Capitol with public officials. Unfortunately, we spend most of our time putting out fires, trying to kill bad legislation. We have a couple of small good things that have happened. And litigation is one thing that we are also participating in at this time. Currently, in the state of Texas, there are over 76,000 people on the public sex offender registry. The last figure I got from the Department of Public Safety is that they are adding an average of between 85 and 100 people to the registry every week. Every week. When we started our brochures almost 6 years ago, it was like, wow, 54,000 people on the registry. We're having to update those brochures every 6 months. That's a lot of people. Like other states, Texas laws and policies have created a mess. Unfortunately, just as they were created slowly, it will take us years to clean them up. Very slow process, little by little. One of the most concerning examples of bad policy is the imposition of residency restrictions. Texas parole and probation have residency restrictions. For someone on probation, it's 1,000 feet from a child safe zone, which is a park, a school, a daycare. Parole is 500 feet. But Texas has no residency restriction or child safe zone law outside of that. So once a person has completed their sentence, they're free to live where they choose to live or visit the locations they choose to visit. The problem is, in Texas, individual cities, towns, and municipalities are allowed to enact their own residency restrictions and child safe zones. We look at some of the cities, and there are over 100 cities and municipalities that have enacted their own restrictions. We look at some of them, 1,500 feet, 1,000 feet, 2,000 feet. What's difficult is, I think the worst thing that we've seen is the guys coming out on parole. Most of them don't have anywhere to go if they're registered. Because of that 500-foot restriction, they're already in a bind. Many of them can't go home, they can't go to mom and dad's, they can't live with a friend, because that home falls within the 500 feet. So if an individual city or town expands it to 1,500 feet, that cuts down on the places for them to live. So we get letters every day from guys in prison saying, I've been paroled, but I'm still here. I have nowhere to go. You know, that's sad. We're talking about reentry, reintegration. We want them to get back into the community. We want them to get a job. We want them to be around their support systems, yet we shut the door on them when they try to do that. Then we have the other folks who have finished their sentence. They're trying the best they can to live in their community. Normally, when a city or municipality puts forth a residency restrictions, they will grandfather, if the person's already living there, they'll grandfather that. However, we know that people on the registry typically are more transient than your normal resident. It could be because the kids in school found out that dad's on the registry and now the family needs to move so that their child can go to another school where their secret will be safe for a while. It could be because the neighbors have called the landlord and the landlord decides they want them to move. So it's not typical that someone who's registered is going to live in a home and stay there for the rest of their life. We have people in our organizations, entire families, who are living in extended stay hotels because there is nowhere in their city for them to live. So one city puts forth a residency restriction. The next city says, wow, are they all going to be moving here? So they put forth the residency restriction, and it's a chain reaction. We've not seen the larger cities go this direction. Last year, Amarillo commissioners proposed an ordinance, and they killed it. Thank God, one of the commissioners said, I just don't see any research here that says we're going to be safer. San Antonio, we are fighting that battle today. I live in San Antonio. City Council and the police chief have put forth the residency restriction. If anybody in here is from San Antonio or knows of someone in San Antonio who could help, please ask them to give me a call. So far, it is only a group of registrants and their family members who have spoken out, and I'm afraid that's not going to cut it, but we're going to fight till the fat lady sings, as they say. So we look at all the other cities, the big cities, Houston, Dallas, Austin, Fort Worth. They've not gone this direction with residency restrictions. if at some point they decide to do that, we will look like Florida, where people are sleeping under the Julia Tuttle Bridge. Parole actually drops them off under the Julia Tuttle Bridge. They finally moved them out of there. Now they're sleeping in behind car washes. They're sleeping on the front steps of the parole and probation office. They're sleeping on bus stop benches. That doesn't sound like public safety to me. I just don't understand why people don't get it. Okay, so what I'd like to share is from our brochure, and I've put some at the back table. Research shows there is no correlation between residency restrictions and reducing sex offenses against children or improving public safety. Research does not support the belief that children are more likely to be victimized by strangers at certain places where children gather. These types of restrictions force entire families from their communities. They force them away from their support systems. They isolate people. They ostracize people. They create instability. They increase isolation. They waste resources. Think about the tax dollars that go to pay for all of the state-run parole facilities. These guys who cannot find a place to live coming out on parole are placed on a list, and when a bed comes up, they go to a parole halfway house. That's tax dollars. A lot of these guys could go home. They could go to a friend's, they could go to a cousin's. They've got a place to go. We get a letter, I would say, almost every week from someone coming out on parole begging us to help them find a place to parole to. It's almost impossible for us. There's just so few resources. I think one of the things that really irritates me is when I hear the legislators say, reentry, reintegration. We're so big on reentry. Look what we're doing. What are they doing? I haven't figured that out yet. At least in the sex offender community, we haven't seen anything positive on reentry. We've seen people get thrown out of their communities and restricted from being with their family, and they can't. This is a good one. This is a parole thing. You can't drive by a park. Not only can you not live by a park or go to a park, you can't drive by a park or a school, so your route has to be planned in advance. What road you're gonna take so that you don't drive by a school. We had one young man who couldn't go home. His mom and dad were not in the child safe zone, but in order to get from their home to his parole office, he had to drive by a school. Folks, I gotta tell you, we understand that there are a few out there who may be dangerous. And if you tell them they can't go to a child safe zone and they can't live here and they can't live there and they can't drive by a school, you're not gonna stop them. If they're intent on committing an offense, what difference does it make where you don't allow them to go? But the vast majority of people on the sex offender registry are simply trying to move on with their life and conduct themselves as we should want them to, which is to reintegrate, get a job, pay their bills, raise their families. So I just have, how much time do I have left? About 5 minutes?
Sure.
Okay, so I just wanna say, reiterate the fact that doing what we do, our organization, very, very difficult. We have support groups for our registrants and their family members in Austin, Dallas, Fort Worth, and one starting in San Antonio. And one of the main problems is housing. trying to find these guys. We're not a real estate company. We cannot find housing for everyone, although we try to connect people that call and contact us to try to find them a place to live. But it's really a sad, sad situation. It's what we call banishment, when we banish people from entire communities. So, folks, I thank y'all very much. And again, I thank you so much for inviting me. And please check out our website, and I'd be happy to give anyone more information.
Thank you, Mary Sue. Our next speaker is Dr. Matthew Ferrara, who is a local forensic psychologist who has long been concerned with these questions. In fact, he actually has a very distinguished and extensive career as the chief psychologist for the Texas Youth Commission. So he's very familiar with, you know, also what the impact of offending can be on young people. He's the chief psychologist for the TDC, the Texas Department of Corrections, and he's really perhaps more responsible than anyone for the training of therapists in sex offender treatment programs, both within Texas and also some outside the state. So we're really pleased to have someone with his level of expertise to tell us about the kind of therapies that are out there and what the best practices are, in his opinion.
Thank you very much. I always try to start out with a story to make it real. So we're going to talk about John, and John's story begins when he's in his second semester here at UT, and he had just completed first semester, did well, first time away from home. He's taken a 15-hour load. He's now in his second semester, so he's a freshman here, and he works at a pizza place, and he meets a girl there, and she's a sophomore. Unfortunately, he learns that she's a sophomore at a high school, but they hit it off. They talk. They get along very, very well. And they go out on a few outings. They weren't dates. They were just outings. And on one of those outings, they kiss and touch sexually. And John's called in by the police and said, "Did you do this?" And he says, "Yes, I did." And they look at it like a Romeo and Juliet type thing, but it's still illegal in Texas, in most states in the union. So he's put on probation. He completes his 5 years, but he has to register for life. You fast forward, John's on the registry. It's 20 years later now. John is on the registry. He's doing quite well. Actually, he switched schools. He got his MBA. He married. He has a child. And for John, he's successful in his work. And he thinks, you know, this is not that bad. I mean, I have to go down and register every year, but I can put up with that. And it's not right now causing me that much interference in my life. He also has a daughter, Annabelle. It's causing her interference. She's in her sophomore year at high school. And in November, she finds a note on her desk, on her locker: "Your dad's a child molester." And at first, it starts out indirectly with notes, and then becomes to her face. The kids start saying, "Your dad's a Chester," and that's short for Chester the molester. And it escalates and escalates. It's going on at school. She doesn't want to tell mom and dad. She feels like she would be bringing dad news he doesn't want to hear. So she suffers in silence, and there's no relief for her. You've just met one of the new victims of the sex offender registry. There's many victims of the sex offender registry. And in fact, there's a lot of research about just how many new victims are created by the sex offender registry. And let me be really, really clear about what I mean by a new victim of the sex offender registry. The registry is causing individuals to be victimized who have never committed a crime and have never gone through the due process of the court system so that they could give up their freedoms or their rights or and their privacy. And you can see right here on this slide, it says that 16 to 19% of those who live with the registrants are harassed, assaulted, injured, or experience some kind of property damage. And you see in the little, I'm a psychologist, so I cite things, I cite the research in what we call APA standard, American Psychological Association standard. So you can see Levinson and Cotter. Those are the authors of this particular research study. The research study was published in 2005. If you go to my website, it's called Deregister Texas. The actual references, you can pull the references off the website, follow those up if you want some more detail. If you ever find yourself in a position where you want to, you know, justify your stance against the registry, then there's a lot of research. As a matter of fact, I'll kind of make a general statement here that I feel, how many of you try to stay away from general statements? I do, but in this case, I'll tell you that I have found no solid, well-done studies that support deregistration reduces sex offender recidivism. There's no studies out there. There are studies out there about the secondary victims. On this slide, you're going to see some more of the research. And once again, when you see things like the first item up there, 67% of family members, some form of harm. That's from Zavettis, and et al. Means there were a bunch of other authors that they didn't fit on this particular slide. Mm-hmm. So, but that study was done in 2000. 67% experienced some kind of harm, and Zavettis had a very broad definition of harm. It could be psychological harm, it could be physical harm, or it could be property harm. Very, very broad definition. The one underneath it, 42% of family members are threatened or harassed. Really? That's not the sex offender doing anything to cause his family members to get harassed. That's the registry. If not for the registry, then that would not have happened. 27% of family members, not just the registrant, experience property damage. And then 7% actually are physically assaulted. Am I talking about the registrant here? No. I'm talking about family and friends of the registrant getting assaulted. That to me is mind-boggling. You might find a way to justify the registry, not necessarily you, the rhetorical you. One might find a way to justify the registry if it worked. But once again, like I said earlier, there's no solid empirical studies to show that sex offender registries work. One of the first studies to come out was by Schramm and Malloy. They took a look at 125 registrants on supervision with the highest level of notification. They looked at 90% of registrants or sex offenders not on registration, no difference in sex offender recidivism. And by recidivism, that might be a term that I'm more familiar with than a lot, but it just means a new sex offense. So there's no difference. You can put them on the registry, and in this particular study, there was no difference between who had a new sex offense and who didn't. Registration did not matter. And about 37% of those who did have a new sex offense didn't even do so in the area where they were registering. So it warned you off immediately as early as the 1990s. Atkinson, Huff, and Strawberger did a nice study in 2000. They followed 223 sex offenders and 201 unregistered sex offenders. The registered sex offenders knew sex offense rate at 3%, the unregistered 3.5%. You can say, aha, we got a half a percent difference. Well, that wasn't statistically significant. It could, that could have just be the result of random error. But take a look at the recidivism rate. Don't just look at, don't just compare the two. How many sex offenders reoffend? In this study, 3%, 3.5%. Now we've got registries out there because they all reoffend, right? That's why we have it done, right? No. We have it because it's an easy way, it's an easy class to attack with new legislation because they don't vote. They don't have the constituency of the politicians passing the legislation is such that they don't have to consider the sex offender. They probably will in Texas now that Mary Sue's here, I like statistics. So the federal government did a study of all kinds of offenders, sex offenders and non-sex offenders, released from prison in 15 states. And what they found was they followed them for a short period of time, 3 to 4 years. Sex offenders recidivated at a rate, or a new offense over that same, over that period, about 5% of the time. Non-sex offenders released from prisons in these 15 states, and Texas was one of the states, 68% of them were rearrested for a new crime. So who do we need to be watching? Let's start a registry for property offenders. I mean, that's excuse me for using reductio ad absurdum, but that's taking the registry notion to its extreme. If you want to watch somebody who's going to reoffend, don't watch sex offenders. Public safety, Prescott and Rockoff. If you really like research, you'll like that study. Very, very tight. But basically, public registration, no effect on recidivism. Private registration, yes. Meaning if you let the law enforcement people know who they are, then that has an impact. Walker in 2005, Vasquez in 2008, these are actually a research group. They looked at sex offender registration in 10 different states, most of them in the South. The conclusion, in 3 states, sexual assault rates went down. In 2 states, sexual assault rates didn't change, and in 5 states, the sexual assault rates increased. Thank you, sex offender recidivism, for giving us a mixed picture. Because are you starting to get the idea that the registry itself does not impact the rate of sex offending? If you're getting that idea, then you have the right idea. And there's the research to support it. Once again, I want to say, you know, if you want to follow up on this research, my website is Deregister Texas. All the references for this presentation are on the website, Deregister Texas. And you can follow up with those. This is another example of a study done by Zavetis. The high-risk registered, the not registered 166 have a lower recidivism rate. We talked about some of the harm to family members who live with a registrant or associated with a registrant. But let's take a look at the registrants themselves. This study is from Levinson, and she had co-researchers in Indiana and Connecticut who were looking at some of the effects of being on the registry. The registrant lost a job in Florida 20% of the time. Landlord made a move 20% of the time. Neighbor made a move. Think about that. A neighbor's making you move. Can your neighbor make you move? Mind-boggling. Property damage, 21% of the time. Threatened, harassed, 33%. Physically assaulted or injured, 21% of the time. That's just in Florida. So as you look at this, but if you're in my shoes and you think like I think, you may not be aware of this, but we have what's called risk assessment devices, and I'll be talking about those in a few minutes. And what a risk assessment device or instrument is it's a checklist. It's an actuarial checklist. And you get smacked around by actuarial checklists every day. When you call up your insurance agent and say, can I get some life insurance? Can I get some car insurance? They'll ask you 4, 5, 6, 7 questions, right? Do you know where the questions come from? The research that the insurance company does. Who's a risk and who's not? They'll ask you questions. You say, I would like to get my car insured. And they'll ask you, well, what's your credit rating? They'll look it up. You go, what? How's that related to car insurance? Well, the research shows your credit rating, it correlates with your driving. And so they base it on that. Do we know that the insurance actuarials work? Sure. Insurance companies make billions of dollars, right? We know this stuff works. In the field of risk assessment, we know that actuarials work too. And when you look at this, you may not know what you're looking at. You're looking at something that shows, wow, a lot of people are harmed by this. But that's actually, in my mind, it overlaps with a risk assessment instrument I know that's called the Stable 2007. What the Stable 2007 says is that if a sex offender doesn't have a stable home, stable family life, stable work, or if they're lonely, depressed, outcast, they're at a higher risk to reoffend. So you may not know what you're looking at. I know what I'm looking at right there. And what I'm looking at is, oh, that may be one reason why the registry doesn't work. It actually increases the risk factors that we know that causes a new sex offense. Incredible. So in Texas, they've started to deregister because it's costing a lot of money. Always follow the money. It costs a lot of money. So there's a way for current registrants in Texas to get off the public registry. And it's a process called deregistration. And there's one item on here that I think may not be entirely right, but I'll let you know when we get to that. If you get off the registry, what does that mean? Well, if there's any non-public registry, like a law enforcement registry, and what I mean by that in particular is the second item there, the DNA registry. If you get off the internet registry, the individual doesn't get off the public registry. I mean, a private registry or the DNA registry. Deregistration can't be used in Texas to expunge a conviction. So if you get them off the public registry, the conviction still stays. It doesn't affect probation or parole status. And that's the item that's wrong. There's a new interpretation of the deregistration laws in Texas. You actually don't have to finish probation or parole to get off the registry right now. And sex offenses will still be part of the individual's criminal record. So if the individual wants to show up and get a job at a school or a daycare center, if they do their due diligence and check the record, they'll find that the individual is indeed convicted for a sex offense. In Texas, who can deregister? You can only have one sex offense on record. So if an individual has one sentencing occasion, let's say they went to court on October 25th, 2005, and they were sentenced for one sex offense, they could be eligible. If they go to court same day, October 25th, 2005, and they got indecency with a child and indecency with a child by exposure. That's two different things, or same offense, two different counts. They cannot deregister. So what I think the intent there was to make sure that we don't get repeat offenders, although two counts from the same sentencing occasion can prevent you from deregistering, which would essentially, you're preventing someone from deregistering who's not a repeat offender. But that's the way it stands right now. Also, after the sex offense, no new criminal conviction that can result in a prison term of 1 year or more. No new misdemeanor or felony sex offenses. Successfully complete supervision. That's changed at this point in time. And you do have to complete sex offender treatment. I do deregistration evaluations here in Texas, and some of the men who call me were convicted in the 60s, 70s, early 80s, and there's no requirement for them to go to sex offender treatment. So if they want to get off the registry, they've got to go to sex offender treatment. The deregistration criteria, I want to focus on the way Texas has set up to identify who should get off the registry. And basically, keep this in mind, what the deregistration process in Texas seeks to do is keep only high-risk offenders on the registry. And as I say that, I'm also keenly aware that there's no research to say if you keep the high-risk offenders on the registry, that'll reduce a new sex offense or rate of sex offending either. But it's a step in the right direction. And we're grateful for every move we have that's a step in the right direction. So there's basically three classes of risk assessment instruments that are used. And I'm gonna show these to you so you kind of get a feel for what goes into doing one of these risk assessments. Two of them are sex offender risk assessments. One is the static 2002. That's used for everybody who has a hands-on type of offense, meaning there was some touching involved, or it could be indecent exposure. The Matrix 2000 is a risk assessment instrument that's used for child pornographers. If your only offense is child pornography, you have a different set of risk criteria than if you're actually touching a child. And then the PCLR is the psychopathy checklist, and then the LSIR is the level of service inventory. And the PCLR measures if you're a psychopath. The LSIR measures if you have a risk for a new law violation. And I just want to just show you these real briefly. The static 2002, basically, the way to understand this is, you imagine that you're a researcher, and someone said, what is the recipe for the sex offender who's most likely to have a new sex offense after they've been caught once? And you'd look first at age. Well, you know what? The younger ones commit more sex offenses than the older ones. Then you'd look at how many other sentencing occasions do they have? And that will get you at the persistence. Deviant sexual interests. If they're selecting male victims, and if they're selecting children, two victims under age 12, unrelated victims, stranger victims. So here's what we know. Incest perpetrators are the least likely to reoffend. Just base rate. If you go back to 1980s, we took a look at that, and from a study done by Gene Abel, he found on average incest perpetrators, where they had male or female victims, about 1.8 victims. Men who select female children outside the home, on average about 20 victims. Men who select male victims outside the home could be upwards of 100 on average. So that's why the gender makes it in there for risk assessments. And then, of course, finally, general criminality. So this is your recipe for who is likely to be the worst offender. And these are the high-risk offenders. And if someone scores a 9 or above on this when we're doing a deregistration evaluation, they don't get off the registry. One high score on any of the three risk assessment instruments will make it so that you can't get off the registry. The LSIR, I apologize for the strange sounding name, but it's level of service inventory. That's what a probation and a parole officer have to figure out. What level of service, in other words, how closely do I have to watch them? And there's these factors over here on the left-hand side, criminal history. If a person has a lot of criminal history, you need to watch them more. If they, and this is really interesting, education. Not if you're uneducated, like you can have someone who's a bachelor's degree individual, but if they didn't actually complete 12th grade, make it all the way through, it shows that they're not a rule follower. If they dropped out and they got a GED, I mean, that's positive, right? But the LSIR is watching you and saying, you know what? If you were not a rule follower way back then, there's a chance you might not be a rule follower now, so you get a point. financial problems. And here, once again, think about the effects of being on the registry and look at some of the items here. Do you have family or marital problems? Well, you do if you're on the registry. Well, that might get you some points on this. Do you have good accommodations, stable accommodations? Well, not if you're on the registry, at least not all the time. Do you have problems with leisure or recreation? So this is a risk assessment instrument designed to identify who's going to commit a new penal code violation. And if you score high, get 16 points or higher on this, you would not be able to deregister. And then we take a look at the hair psychopathy checklist. And really there's two factors. One is personality issues, and the other is behavioral issues. Under the personality, the psychopath tends to be glib and superficial, grandiose, they're pathological liars, they con, manipulate, lack of remorse. Behavioral issues, basically that's just a criminal lifestyle. High need for stimulation, in other words, they're thrill seekers. Parasitic lifestyle, they can work, but they choose to live off of family, friends, spouse. So it's really hard to get a high score on the hair psychopathy checklist. There's 40 possible points, and you have to get a 30 or higher. And so once you make that 30 or higher, you're in the high risk category, you would not get off the registry. What I will tell you is that when it comes to deregistering, I would be surprised if 90% of the people currently on the registry couldn't get off. I mean, let me say that another way. 90% will probably be eligible to get off. In other words, 10% are likely to fall into the high risk area. So that's a good thing. Here's the bad part. How many? We're putting on 100 every week. I mean, are we making any? It's like you're bailing the water out of a boat and there's still a hole in the bottom. I mean, close it up. I mean, maybe we'll handle that this year coming up, you know. I think we ought to do the evaluations before they're put on the registry, and if they're high risk, go ahead and put them on. And I'd like to see that legislation passed in Texas. I think the other thing is this costs money. It costs money for an evaluation, and if you're wise, you'll have an attorney. Because let's say you pass the evaluation, then you have to petition the court. You go to court, and you better have a good attorney who can smooth the way before you even get there and represent you while you're there. So even though technically lots and lots of people are eligible to register, not a lot of people know about it and not a lot of people can afford it. And I'm not sure how much time I have left. Did I just go over?
You have 4 minutes.
4 minutes, okay. I just want to talk about obstacles to change. So I'm a psychologist. And what I will talk about is the psychological obstacles to change. And I always, for me, it comes down to heuristics. It's a psychological term that Daniel Kahneman, Amos Tversky came up with. And basically, heuristics are the quick and dirty way we process information. And I think there's some quick and dirty ways that we process information about sex offenders that keep us, that keep people from changing. And it's these three heuristics. Number one is the availability heuristic. When I say sex offender, what comes to your mind? If you're like most people, and you may not be, but if you're like most people, you think about what you recently saw on TV about the sex offender. What type of sex offender makes the news? Is it the 30-year-old dad who's sorry he had, you know, sexual contact with his stepdaughter, he's doing good on probation, he's working hard? Mm-mm. It's the only person who gets on TV is the one who creates strong emotion. He's the one who does the fantastic sex crime that's newsworthy. So when we say sex offender and getting them off the registry, you know what you're talking about. I mean, I know what I'm talking about. I've got 25 years of experience, and it's a heterogeneous group. That's not the way it is to everybody. There's you would call it a stereotype, but what I'm telling you is it runs deeper than that. It's not just a stereotype. We're being controlled by the availability heuristic, And you're saying one thing is, and you're talking cross purposes to the person you're trying to influence. That's a big problem. The other is the affect heuristic. The man on the left, what's the first word that comes to your mind when you look at the man on the left? Don't say it out loud. First word that comes to your mind when you see the bearded man. Who's the sex offender? The research says it could be either one of them, and it's probably neither, because base rate of sex pedophilia in the general population is incredibly low. It's 3% is as high as a figure I've ever seen. So if you go with base rates, you better say neither of them are sex offenders. But you say sex offender, and it conjures up an affect or an emotion. And while the person is busy thinking about the availability heuristic, like what did I hear Nancy Grace say on TV last night about sex offenders, and the emotions that it stirs, then you also get to the substitution, and I'll tell you about that. And so here's a good example of substitution. If right now you were asked to turn to the person to your right and tell them your deepest, darkest sexual secret, you would turn to the person to your right and tell them something, but it sure as heck wouldn't be your deepest, darkest sexual secret. You would substitute something else. And so when you start talking to them about how complex other people, and you're trying to influence them, and you're talking with them about how complex this problem is and how they need to understand, they're substituting a completely different question in their mind. They're stirred by the emotions. They have the availability of the last thing they saw on TV, and it's very difficult to reach them. So the recipe for the message, you can tell after doing lots of risk assessments, I always come down to recipes. I think it comes down to three components. The media, you have to use everything. You have to talk to the part of the brain, which is the copier of the message. You have to talk to the part of the brain that's operating on heuristics, and there's only one way to do it. You go to the spa, and there's research on this. It's called you use sound, picture, and analogy. And the sound can be rhymes, jingles. They need to get out there. Pictures of people actually on the registry doing well. Analogies. I just used one earlier, you know, about bailing. You're bailing water out of the boat, but there's still a hole in the bottom. I mean, just getting those pictures in people's minds, that's what you have to do. And truly, I don't think until we get experts and celebrities involved in this cause that we're going to see much of a change. But at least we know that, at least we know there's hope for some of the things we're working on. And we'll continue to do so. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Brock. We really appreciate having the benefit of your expertise. Our final speaker is also a man with a different kind of expertise, and that's Bill Andriette, who's a gay journalist who's written many very incisive articles on the way that sex offender laws have been taken to very problematic extremes in our society. But Bill's coming at this from a somewhat different and challenging perspective today, questioning whether the conventional human rights agenda is really even adequate to deal with the depth and severity of the perception problem here.
Thank you, Tom, and thank you, Yasmin, for your introduction before. Do you have any insight into how to get this?
It works much better if you put a memory stick in the computer that's there. No, you really need to use the one that's there.
I was. I have it on here. If I could do it on there, that'd be great.
Okay. And what was the issue you were just talking about? I plugged it in, but the image didn't show up.
Is there going to be audio as well?
No audio.
Well, thank you again, Tom and Yasmin. I really wanted to dig into the question of do sex offenders have human rights? And I think the answer is no. And so the next question is, what else can we give them that might be useful? And since I'm giving this talk in Texas, I thought I would start with a Bible story. So everyone, take out your Bibles and turn to Numbers 31. And we'll hear about Moses and the Midians. So the Israelites had just vanquished the Midians, and they did what they'd be expected to do, killed all the leaders and the soldiers, and the victorious Israelites brought the women and children to Moses. And Moses and all the leaders of the congregation went to meet the officers of the army outside the camp. Moses became angry with them, the commanders of thousands, who had come from service in the war. Moses said to them, "Have you allowed the women to live? These women here, on Balaam's advice, made the Israelites act treacherously against the Lord so that the plague came among the congregation of the Lord. Now, therefore, kill every male among the little ones and kill every woman who has known a man by sleeping with him. But all the young girls who have not known a man by sleeping with him, keep alive for yourselves." So I mentioned this in part for the little detail about these pubescent girls being the prize for Moses' soldiers, but more importantly because the Old Testament, that first great Western monotheistic text, is a seminal work in the history of human rights. The assertion that there is but one God is a projection of humanity's dawning realization that there's just one humanity. If talk about human rights seems very civilized and safe and warm and cuddly to the touch, we should make a distinction between, say, lukewarm water that's at room temperature, just because it happens to be that way, and lukewarm water that you get by pouring boiling water over ice. The regime of human rights is a product of a history of immense violence, and that violence lurks just behind the plush curtains and rich paneling of places like the Council of Europe. If we needed any reminder of that, yesterday we had a great quote from the French Revolution about the rights of man extend to as far as they possibly could go, except hurting somebody else. But don't forget, that was a pearl of wisdom pulled from the crucible of the French Revolution and the Reign of Terror. And in the same way, all the infrastructure of human rights that we've been talking about, so much of it seems sort of European-centered, in its full flower, is a product of World War II and genocide, and a very deliberate and self-conscious reaction to that. Sometimes the violence that's tightly coiled within the regime of human rights pokes through. We've heard a lot about the positive side of sexual citizenship over the last few days, the idea of the sexual citizen enjoying legally codified guarantees, respect for personal integrity and freedom. But the irony is that hand in glove with this regime of the somewhat glorified sexual citizen who has rights and hate crimes protection and freedom to marry, hand in glove with that is the creation of a person who has sort of an anti-sexual citizenship, and that's the people we've been talking about today. People subjected to the revocation of rights, to modalities of shaming, stripping of their humanity that recall some of the worst excesses that modern states can dish out. So the question is there some occult connection between these very contrary developments? Does the rise of the rights-endowed sexual citizen entail in some way the hateful anti-citizen? Or is it just the case that sexual citizenship and human rights haven't extended far enough yet? I wanted to call my talk Against Human Rights, but really I only want to raise some questions as to whether it's really the tool that can get the job done in some of these most difficult areas. I'd like to do three things. One, point out the remarkable failure, even sometimes the complicity, of the human rights apparatus, as I'll call it, at dealing with some of these most egregious and dangerous things that are now happening in Western jurisprudence. Two, relate some of these failures to some critiques of human rights that have been made. There actually are critiques of human rights out there, though they're not on the tip of everyone's tongue. And three, to suggest some alternative approaches that might replace or fill gaps that the human rights approach seems to be failing at. What motivates these worries is not some abstract worry about human rights, but a sense of frustration at how actually existing human rights groups and doctrines have been applied in this area. Many writers and some speakers at this conference have talked about the connection between sex offenders and terrorism, but rarely has this been made so explicit as it is here. This really hasn't panned out. It really hasn't turned out that terrorists are using kiddie porn to encode messages about, you know, where the suicide bombs should go. But it really does speak to sort of the unconscious fears that are working in this area. And in fact, the new kinds of laws and legal procedures legal structures that have developed in this area go hand in hand and in some ways curiously anticipate what has happened in the realm of terror. So in 1997, preemptive incarceration for sex offenses you might commit in the future was accepted by the U.S. Supreme Court, and that in some ways became the model for Guantanamo. Crimes based on mere intent, such as selling a Bible that you claim has racy pictures of kids, carries the same penalty as actually selling those pictures. Intention to travel for illicit sex overseas. All these things have parallels in what's happening in terrorism law, where people get lengthy sentences for giving money to a charity in Gaza or transmitting a cable TV channel linked to Hezbollah. Together with developments around terrorism, the legal apparatus around sex offenders has become the most dynamic and expansive domain where the state extends its reach and justifies its legitimacy. The system is still quickly evolving, yet it's not just a zone where the law expands and develops, it's also a zone where anything like what law is crumbles and collapses, and you just end up with sort of raw power. We just were talking about risk assessment, and I was talking to Mary Sue last night about an offender who wanted to get a new risk assessment because the one that was given to him when he first committed his offense, he was 19, the girl was 16, is that what you said? Put him in a high risk category. But this is another area where we should really recognize what's a real miscarriage of justice. I mean, imagine someone who's a burglar and the judge at sentencing says, well, you're a Hispanic male, you're 25 years old, you've got only $2,000 in the bank. Normally, I'd send someone like you, to 3 months in jail, but because you fit a demographic category that's very likely to commit a crime in the future, we're going to give you 5 years in jail. So this idea of punishing people according to risk assessments for groups that they could be said to belong to is violates basic principles of justice. But in this domain, we've seen basic principles of justice violated time and again. And it's almost a kind of theater, a spectacle, throwing Christians to the lions kind of situation. There's plenty of atrocity cases we can talk about, and I think people have covered some already, so I'll go over this quickly. But this is a woman who got a life sentence for letting a 13-year-old boy touch her breast. In Colorado in 2007, a 44-year-old former Catholic priest was sentenced to 18 years to life in prison for horseplay that happened 10 years before with male teenagers 16 and 17. He caressed the 17-year-old under his boxer shorts while wrestling and grabbed the buttocks of the other boy. The two youths each received something like $300,000 from the diocese. So, who knows what the reality of those stories were in the situation where so much hung on the on making the claim. 200-year sentence for someone possessing pornography, first offense, upheld by the Supreme Court. Life sentence here in Texas for a cross-dresser who invited a 13-year-old boy to have sex with him. It's very, this article is kind of interesting because it endows the 13-year-old with full volition. It says, oh, he wanted to have sex with a woman, but he ended up with a cross-dresser. And we've talked about the sex offender registry and how it becomes a framework for a completely totalizing subjection to the state. Another key aspect of what's emerged in the West is this kind of freewheeling Dionysian rhetoric of hatred and acceptable violence that occurs around sex offenders. You know, comments like this, there's just, you know, millions of them you could find on newspaper comment sections or blogs, but here's a couple. This is from the Des Moines Register. I still say we just kill all the pedophiles. I believe it's every citizen's duty to rid the world of these scum. In an actual case where a man was killed in prison, when the article discussing his death appeared in the Bangor Daily News, there were 70 of 76 reader comments expressing an opinion praising the murder. That this splendid specimen of a human is passed on to his just rewards is not worthy of a single tear, nor a taxpayer-funded examination into his death. From the Boston Herald, our society is ever increasing with monsters looming amongst us. The liberals won't let us kill them and won't keep them locked up. And not surprisingly, these cases, cases of murder, particularly in prison but also out of prison, are very common. There's a website, e-advocate blog, I think it's a WordPress site, that chronicles these things, and there's, you know, dozens and dozens and dozens every year, and they don't get much reporting. So there's a lot of material here for human rights groups to do some work, but what have they actually done? This is one measure. No results for the search term sex offender on the AI site, and no results for civil commitment. The one thing I did find on the Amnesty International site was a complaint about Armenia. They cited a case where a man got 15 years for sex with teenage boys, but a man who had allegedly sex with girls got only 2 years, and they said that this disparity was terrible and that the second man should get a much higher sentence. So it's a curious space for a human rights group to be occupying. Now, Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, I'm getting ahead of myself here, has actually weighed into this area more substantially. But I would say in general that the response of human rights groups has been characterized by timidity, sloppiness, disrespect for basic standards of free expression, and alignment with the very ideological movements that drive the most extreme abuses. Human Rights Watch waited 10 years after civil commitment was established in the U.S. to say anything about it, and then what they said left a lot to be desired. They didn't say that proactively imprisoning people for crimes they might commit in the future was a bad thing. They didn't say what they said about it. They didn't have anything to say about it, as whether it was good or bad. But they urged that governments exercise caution when doing this and only focus on the worst offenders. And then they go on to say that men convicted of homosexual offenses, as we've just heard, have the highest recidivism rates. So it sounds like Human Rights Watch thinks that prospective incarceration of homosexuals who might have sex with minors is a good idea. In January 2010, Human Rights Watch asserted in a Boston Globe op-ed that critics of closing Guantanamo were wrong when they said that this would be a precedent for shutting down civil commitment facilities. So they, again, sort of put themselves on the map as endorsing prospective punishment. In 2010, Elena Kagan, then Solicitor General, now our first presumptive lesbian Supreme Court Justice, defended the federal government's right to put people in civil commitment, even who haven't been convicted of a crime, who merely were in federal custody. And I think she was dealing with five cases, and I think four of the five cases dealt with mere pornography offenses. So it shows the vigor with which the federal government is probably going to pursue civil commitment. Another example that should have been just obvious to civil human rights groups is the question of the death penalty. The U.S. in 2008 was heading toward establishing the death penalty for what was called child rape. Indeed, the two cases where someone had been sentenced to death, one was a real genuine child rape, the other was much more ambiguous. It's not even clear to me from what I've read about the case that any penetration went on. And to their credit, Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, they said this was a bad thing to do. But they weren't very curious about what the laws that had been passed actually mandated or allowed. So in Georgia, for instance, a 19-year-old girl having oral sex with a 15-year-old boy and then eloping with him would have been eligible for the death penalty. Oklahoma went further and made internet sex chat among adults where one pretended to be underage a death-eligible offense in some circumstances. And this was just completely not noticed by anybody, such as the power of the totem of that term child rape. Child pornography, as we were talking about yesterday, deals in many cases with depictions of acts that are completely legal. And so you'd think, again, a human rights group would weigh into this area when people are getting life sentences for possession of such images. But they haven't, they've completely avoided that subject. The root problem, I think, is that Human Rights Watch takes the same absolutist attitude towards sex involving young people as the victimology theory that's driving the hysteria. And they're completely on board with what Helmut Graupner yesterday was talking about, the plague of 17-year-old children, because they're very rigorous about defining anyone under 18 as a child. And they completely ignore sort of the recent history of sexual victimology, its equation of all sex between older and younger people with father-daughter incest, its refusal to consider consent, to distinguish penetration from non-penetration, or even sex involving people of relatively the same age when they're youngsters. And we don't hear anything about the satanic abuse, the hysteria, the recovered memory, fraud, that emanated from this very broad-scale view of sexual harm to the young. So they say, you know, the sort of the standard view that sex involving young people produces anxiety, eating disorders, guilt, fear, withdrawal, self-destructive behavior, sexual acting out. And they emphasize that these results don't differentiate between victims abused by adults and those abused by other children. So I think it's useful, since this claim of severe harm is at the root of so many of these forms of violence and legal, transgression of legal principle that we see, to just dip briefly into this area. The 1998 Ryan study that was condemned by U.S. Congress, the take-home message there was that if 2 out of 100 people in a community sample are found to have significant psychological problems by standard measure, then if you look at only people with the experience of child sexual abuse, again by standard definitions, the number is 3 out of 100. So that's a you could say it's 50% more, but that's really a very tiny difference. And when you measure it in relation to confounding variables such as broken homes, rejecting parents, other things that are associated with child sexual abuse, then even that difference goes away. Here's another recent study. Now, this is based on the data set from the Kinsey sample, one of the most robust, large-scale data sets around. The researcher took out the forensic portion of that sample, so people in prison were mental hospitals were taken out. So this looks at first post-pubescent coitus, and so girls who 11 to 14 who had sex with men were just as positive about the experience, 17%, relatively low, as woman-man first coitus, 18%. That's what everyone says is the proper way to go, and it was significantly more positive than ephebophilic girls 15, 17 with men, or girl-male peer first coitus, both at 12%. So girls actually enjoyed sex more with older people, with older men, than they did with peers, even as when that first coitus was with adults. Or turning to male homosexuality, a 2011 study from Brazil looking at gay men, they'd looked at 500 subjects, very robust sample. One third had what the researchers called childhood sexual experiences. They didn't put a value judgment on it. Their first child sexual experience was at, on average, at age 9, with a partner on average age 19, who was usually male. A few older partners were female. And most of the sex involved, you know, real sex, intimate contact, oral, anal, or anal sex. So the result there, 57% reported liking the experience, 29% were indifferent, 14% reported not liking, and only 29% considered it abuse. And penetrative sex was not associated with a negative response, which is sort of an amazing finding. Now, this isn't to say, you know, that these sexual acts are wise, are good, are prudent. This isn't to say that society doesn't have the right to regulate these things, create punishments, discourage them. This isn't to suggest that there might be appropriate modes of surveillance over these things by parents, by friends, or options for you know, getting out of sexual relationships that are not wanted, counselors available. But the main point here is that the sense that we're dealing with some cataclysmic phenomenon here that's just completely unlike other kinds of human interaction, and so justifies these profound punishments and surveillance, just doesn't seem to hold up. And Human Rights Watch wants to show its victimological credentials on its sleeve. After they describe the terrible effects of sexual abuse, and obviously there can be terrible effects in cases that are real abuse, they then go on to give an example. And so they give an example of Denise, a single mother of two boys, Troy, age 15, and Ted, age 12. Denise recalled the day Ted confided in her that he had been sexually abused by Troy. Quote, Ted explained that he had been touched on his private parts, unquote, by his older brother. And Denise goes on to say, I felt I had heard the worst thing a mother can hear. So this is just, you know, incredible dramaturgy about something touching among two boys, yes, they're brothers, roughly the same age. An anthropological perspective on this kind of behavior, I'm sure, would show this is nearly normative. But Human Rights Watch feels that the only way it can talk about these issues in a human rights context is to accept the prevailing ideology, which is precisely what causes the problems that they claim to be trying to address. Well, one approach would be to say, well, if human rights gets this wrong, we need to work within the human rights context and make human rights groups be more thoughtful about these kinds of issues. But there's reason to think that, going back to the initial point, that maybe human rights is a kind of problematic area. Maybe it's a space that has a kind of curvature to it. And so when you think you're shooting in one place, you know, shooting a certain target, you end up, you know, getting the arrow in your back. And there may be two ways of thinking about the problems with human rights. I'll offer divide them as top-down and bottom-up kinds of problems. Here's a top-down example that should be very interesting to us, because it's a case of how a human rights conference launched one of the worst genocides of the 20th century. And I hope nothing follows like that from this one. The year is 1889, and King Leopold of Belgium, who was already honorary president of the British Aborigines Protection Society, launched what was the most lavish international anti-slavery conference, inviting all of the major powers to Brussels. And anti-slavery was kind of, you know, the precursor to human rights. And the focus of this conference was the problem of Arab slavers who plied the coast of Africa and, you know, sold slaves in Turkey and other places where it was still legal. Now, the reason why King Leopold threw this conference was that he was looking to the rival powers in Europe, who had gotten sort of a head start on colonialism, to get a freer rein in the Congo, where he was setting up shop. And he needed to present himself, and very successfully did, as a great humanitarian. And this conference really did the trick. By the end of the 1920s, King Leopold's dominion over the Congo and his exploitation of rubber there, and his enslavement of people in the Congo to get this rubber, we have some pictures, maybe not, killed upwards of 10 million people. And one thing that critics of the human rights movement point out is that this did not, you know, provoke a crisis and cause the development of human rights infrastructure. It was, it, you know, took the Nazis and paroxysms in Europe to do that. But it does show that the value to states and the value to imperialism of being seen to be interested in human rights. And here's another anecdote about human rights that I can speak to, actually from some personal experience. And and the theme here is how, because human rights is so prestigious and states want to have, you know, be able to wear the banner of human rights, that it's also a prestigious attainment for say identity groups who are getting up in the world and want to make a claim. So in America we have the Human Rights Campaign, and that's the largest LGBT group in the U.S. And it's and in that case, human rights is just used sort of a code word for homosexuality, but it's a way of linking oneself to, you know, what is the ideology that really legitimates Western states. So I was involved in the International Lesbian Gay Association in the 80s and 90s, and it was a mostly European-centered organization at that point. I was there both as a delegate and journalist. And one of the founders of ILGA was a French Baptist minister and psychologist, Pastor Joseph Doucet. And he would have been very much at home at this conference. He ran a sexualities community center in Paris and had a very broad-minded view of sexual liberation and all sort of tied up with his Christianity, his radical Christianity, Centre du Christ Libérateur. So it was a ministry to sexual minorities, and he had support groups around homosexuality, transsexuality, sadomasochism, prisoners, and as well pedophiles. And he had a book publishing operation. He became a target of investigation by this branch of the French National Police, Renseignement Général, RG, that gathers intelligence on political subjects. And he was getting harassment. The center was broken into. And then in July 1990, two men in plain clothes knocked on his door and showed him a badge and took him away. His body was found about 5 months later. The police held on to the body for a year and a half. Press accounts right at the time very openly said that the secret police, these perhaps rogue secret police, right wing, who had been linked to the bombing of the Rainbow Warrior, that Greenpeace boat, that they were probably involved in his disappearance and murder. And the murder has never been solved. So around this time as well, in ILGA, there was efforts to campaign groups like Human Rights Watch to take on the gay cause more aggressively. And in 1994, there was a big break for getting recognition for LGBT rights in the human rights context. And there was an opportunity for ILGA to become a consulting member of the Economic and Social Council at the United Nations. But the UN heard about that there were groups in ILGA that dealt with age of consent issues and pedophilia, and they said, we will block this membership unless you get rid of these groups. And so there was the International Lesbian Gay Human Rights Commission, which was sort of embedded within ILGA, took upon itself to do that purge. So Joseph Doucet, who was murdered a few years earlier, would have been kicked out of ILGA. His group would have been kicked out of ILGA had he been around. So we're dealing with what was a very severe human rights issue. I mean, obviously, when the government is killing somebody, and that's what it seems, the government of a major Western state, that's the sort of thing that really rises to the top. If the government is killing people, then you really don't have any protection, human rights protections. But Doucet's murder was completely hushed up. International Lesbian Gay Human Rights Commission, when asked why they did nothing about his case, no public pronouncements, they said, we deal with the global south, we deal with Eastern Europe, Western Europe, really, no problems.
Bill, we're going to have to bring this to a close.
All right.
Like, 1 minute.
Okay. And then very interestingly, I think the people who led this purge ended up going on and being sort of the lead LGBT activists at these very mainstream groups. So that was sort of the reward for covering this up. Scott Long in particular, who led this purge later on, you know, for about 10 years, worked at Human Rights Watch as their lead LGBT person. So I think it really shows the ways in which the construction of a sexual citizen who's endowed with human rights is intricately connected with the sort of deconstruction of a anti-citizen who is defined by being unendowed. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Can we get Yasmin back on?
Okay.
Okay, we do have some time for questions and comments from the audience. Do we have a volunteer to help circulate the microphone?
It's great, Tom. This is the third session in which speakers have drawn our attention to serious problems that are getting in the way of human rights. And consequently, it is time to raise a question. There's a certain amount of denial in the conference. The denial is, where are these problems and contradictions and the ambiguities and the difficulties coming from? Well, Bible's flavor of the month today. So, let's have another biblical passage. The road to hell is paved with good intentions. And the problems we've seen occur, all being raised on pornography, on sexual assaults, and now on the problems we've got with sex offenders, are down to the political approach that has been adopted for the last 40 years. Because if you're promoting human rights to empower your little group to try and put your ideology to the forefront, you're obviously going to exclude other people. I'll just pick one example. It's quite clear where the modern version of the boogeyman came from. It came from the people who promote the kind of question that I was asked yesterday. It's also a problem when we see how people have tried to put their crusades into practice. I'm very, very interested in what we've heard about sex offender registers today, but there was one thing missing. How many people on those registers were actually innocent? They didn't actually commit the offence that they were convicted of. But how did they get convicted? Because an ideologically motivated paediatrician made up a positive medical result when it was really negative. When a social worker decided to encourage a child to reinterpret an event or make up one completely. We haven't discussed this. Bill finally mentioned the satanic abuse debacle. In England, we just didn't have the satanic abuse. We had our own historic allegations. Oh, there are not too many Catholics in England, so what you do, you go after care home workers. There's no evidence, there's no DNA. You can make it up. And thanks to the new Labour government, you get 50,000 quid whether or not the person gets convicted. It's a bribe to make a false allegation. And what was happening in England is, here's the funny thing, all the juvenile delinquents of 30 years ago who never got their act together suddenly had an abuse excuse. And 50,000 quid, $75,000, as a reward for making an allegation. The funny thing was, who did they accuse? The best social workers in the care homes, because they were the only ones they could possibly remember. What we need to do, if we wish to promote human rights and avoid Bill's curve and the arrow in the back, is drop promoting our own political perspectives and promote human rights across the board, even to those groups that we may personally disapprove of. I'm an old-fashioned liberal. No fear, no favor. I believe in human rights.
Do you have a question here?
Yes. Why are we in denial?
Does anyone have an answer to that question?
I'm not sure. What are we in denial about? I'm not clear on what we're in denial about.
The origin of one of the very problems that you raised this morning in how a lot of people are suffering from the very institutions that are supposed to make life so much better. If you give state powers to control people, the state is going to use those powers on the groups that it would prefer to exclude. That is why you have to promote human rights completely across the board and not be selective.
Precisely this issue around human rights, it can actually be an obstacle. That's where Bill is coming from. And I'll let Bill answer that. But I don't think there's anyone on this panel or anyone like Debbie Nathan and so many other amazing people joining the Jews Guild who has ever not written about the fictitious nature of many of those charges, which is something that I heard you talking about. But, you know, I'm not to leave it to Bill, but I do think that the problem with the construction of human rights is that it inherently divides people into deserving and undeserving. And
not inherently, no. I disagree.
I'm trying to get away from. And I think Bill can actually tackle that question much more.
I don't think it inherently divides people between deserving and undeserving, but I think the processes, the institutions.
That's what I meant, right.
Yeah,
right.
Do that. And,
exactly.
I was cut off from my third area, but just very briefly, there are other approaches that we can think about besides human rights, and I think human rights is like a fact on the ground. It's not going to go away. It has real value. People know the words and the rhetoric, and it's a useful tool potentially, though dangerous as well. But there are other approaches. I mean, we can think about a yardstick that says we want a society with more diversity. And that diversity, we're willing to have diversity at the expense of equality. We're willing to have it be the case that disparaged forms of sexuality are lower on the totem pole and don't get all these official blessings, but we allow them to exist. We create space for them. I think that's a better approach than a demand for strict equality that and sameness, in effect, that produces these surpluses of extreme demonization.
But can we also have the celebration of complete diversity? I mean, there are certain groups, for example, that would wish to exclude sadomasochism because it's allegedly violent.
Yeah, I'm sure we have some other questions. Yes, at the back of the room. Bill, can you take the microphone to the man at the back of the room? No, at the back of the room.
I just have a question for Mary Sue.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't think it's on either. Yeah, I think this thing's just kind of.
It looks good in his hand.
I don't think it's at all. I don't really need the microphone. I think you can hear me, right?
No, you do need it.
I do need it. Working now? Is that good?
Speak directly into the microphone.
I'm speaking directly into the microphone. I can't, I'm not going to put my lip on it.
If you speak loudly, it can be heard, I think. I'll tell you what, would you mind coming up to the podium and ask your question? I mean, I don't know why the mic, you can repeat the question.
Does this one work?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, so my question is basically, you talked about legislation and that, and I'm just wondering if anybody has challenged the constitutionality of, you know, the housing restrictions and that, in terms of the Eighth Amendment, the which prohibits cruel and unusual punishment. Has anybody brought that up in court?
I have to speak into the microphone.
Yes.
We have not challenged that. We are looking at, we would like to see legislation where Texas would do like Kansas has done and prohibit individual towns and cities from imposing their own residency restrictions. We'd like to see that. As far as a constitutional challenge, we have not, although we do participate in litigation. Mm-hmm. The problem is these types of legal challenges are extremely expensive. And although we can afford to, you know, foot some of the bills for them, they can run into the thousands and thousands of dollars. So we basically have to find an attorney who's interested as well in helping with that.
What if you found a paralegal who basically could represent... could represent himself in propria persona in court and brought up the challenges on those issues? Because, you know, I just personally, as I told you on the phone, I represented myself in the California, up to the California Supreme Court where I won. Mm-hmm. And I went to paralegal school after that. Mm-hmm. And so I think that, I think there's no question that, you know, a person who has committed, for example, an offense that carries 2 years, they're sentenced to 2 years in prison, they have to really serve a life term on this registration and a life sentence. Whereas a murderer, someone who commits cold-blooded murder, can serve 10 years, get out, and never have to worry about the law again. And I think that, you know, that constitutes you know, a violation of the Eighth Amendment for cruel and unusual punishment. And I was just wondering if you guys had challenged that based on that.
We have not, but, you know, we're always looking for ideas. We're always looking for new avenues to push forward, and we would certainly like to sit down and talk with you.
Okay, I'd like to sit down and talk.
We like paralegals very much.
All right. Okay, thanks.
No, and we applaud your success in California. Thank you. Jim Hunter has a question. Jim, again, can you come up to the podium?
I think this is working.
Oh, now it is working?
Yes.
This really is a question, and I would like to address it to Dr. Ferrara. And I'm curious what the data show about how accurate these risk assessments are in predicting recidivism.
The statistic that's used is an area under the curve statistic. It's from the family of statistics known as receiver operator characteristics. Began in 1947 when the military was trying to identify how accurate sonar was. Since that time, the area under the curve statistic has been studied, and it's been further developed, and now used with sex offenders. We recognize that these risk assessment instruments get an AUC statistic of about 0.71, 0.72. That roughly translates to 71-72% accuracy. There's a context for that. The context is, without the risk assessment instruments, clinical guesses, or guesses by the public, runs at about 50% accuracy, flip a coin. So the movement from 71 to 72% is an increase of 42, 43% accuracy. Nothing's 100%. The same area under the curve statistic is used to evaluate medical assessment techniques. Area under the curve statistic for a hip x-ray is approximately 0.77. So these risk assessment instruments, which don't really take into account things like, demographics other than age, certainly don't take into account race. They compare favorably to medical tests that are being done that we all routinely rely on.
I would just like to add that when what's at stake is life imprisonment or in civil commitment, anything less than beyond a reasonable doubt is a moral outrage.
And just for point of clarity, the risk assessment instruments are not used in the state of Texas to identify who's civilly committed. In the state of Texas, a predator is defined in terms of number of convictions that they have, and risk assessments are generally used in Texas to relieve people from onerous sanctions put on them by the courts.
Okay, thank you. Do we have another question from the audience? Well, if not, then let us close this panel. And we will have a 15-minute break and resume promptly at 11:20. We've got coffee outside.
Yay.
Let's close. Yasmin, just a second.
Hey. Is that Bill?
That's me, yeah.
I don't know if I can see anybody on the other end. It's so strange.
There's a whole, he's very, I was surprised at how well he's discussed on the web. I can show you. I mean, I can just.
But ultimately,
it's just Joseph. Yeah,
I just apologize to you if I seem like.
No.
Good morning.
Wir sind zu Fuß gegangen und sind wiederum mit dem Regen.
Oh, regnet das noch?
Es hat, ich weiß nicht. Also vor einer Stunde, vor anderthalb Stunden. Die meisten sind mit dem Bus gefahren und wir sind gelaufen.
Ach so.